What I'm saying to my business leaders, number one, we are going to become the most business-friendly city on the globe.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to Talks at GS. I am very pleased to be here with New York City's Mayor Eric Adams. I think you all know that Mayor Adams was elected to be the 110th mayor of New York City last November. He had served two terms as the Brooklyn Borough President and four as a New York State Senator. And prior to that, I think you all know that he was a New York City police officer for 20 years on the force. 22 years. And of course, we're all very grateful for your service and very grateful for all the people who serve, you know, us in this great city. And so today we're gonna talk a little bit about what's going on in New York, a little bit about the mayor himself, and again, just thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
So let's talk election night. When you got the word that you were elected the mayor of New York City, what was the first thing that crossed your mind?
Probably mom. Ah. You know, a mother had six children. And I tell everyone, she loved all of us, single mom. But she just adored me. I was just her child, and she transitioned in April. I think about her all the time, and I remember sitting in the hospital room, and the doctor called me, and he stated, "Eric, your mother's not going to make it." And the rest of my siblings were not able to get to the hospital at the time, and I was sitting there and watching the heart monitor, and of course, it was a sad moment, and you know, I cried a bit. But it was just a special moment to see this woman with her third grade education. Just gave me so much wisdom. And when I walked on that stage, I remember walking on the stage when I did a play, and I was nervous and I was scared. And she leaned over and whispered in my ear, "Baby, you got this." And I heard her when I walked on that stage. I heard mommy say, "Baby, you got this."
That's great. That's really nice. You've been in office for 2 months, and so just how does it feel to be the mayor of New York City?
You know, I joke all the time that Sheena Wright, my deputy mayor, we have this saying, I am so scared that I'm not scared. And, you know, this, like, I've come to grips with that I'm perfectly imperfect. And so if you don't run around trying to be perfect, if you just get up and do the best you can, and we spend the bulk of our life being disappointed of things that happen to us and afraid of what's going to happen, that we don't live in the present. I'm just living in the present.
Yeah.
And as I see these challenges, losing two officers, being in the hospital with them, watching a major fire where we lost New Yorkers, but also seeing the joy of this city, dealing with hate crime, anti-Semitism, dealing with anti-Asian violence, all of these things that are coming so fast. I went from drinking from a garden hose to a fire hose. But as long as you are grounded, when I get up in the morning, do that meditation, my breathing exercise, get my green smoothie, get on my exercise bike, and just say, "Hey, Royal, I'm just ready. I am unafraid. There's no anxiety. I am so at peace. And know that I'm going to give New Yorkers my all." And that's all I can do. That's within my span of control.
You're here on the same day that you're lifting the city's vaccine mandate for indoor restaurants, events. You're ending mask mandates in schools, you know, all around this time frame of year. Talk about how you view kind of this start of the city's reopening.
2001, September 11th. Mm-hmm. Not too far from here, our center of trade was attacked. We watched those two buildings collapse. Every year, we acknowledge the loss of lives in the city. And I was a lieutenant at the time. And I remember watching a large number of my friends and colleagues also die. And we focus on that day. I don't. I acknowledge the day, but I focus on September 12th. We got up.
Yeah.
Teachers taught, retailers sold their goods, builders built, and the entire country looked towards New York City. And when we got up, our country realized the resiliency of who we are. And we're there again. COVID is not terrorism, but it has brought terror. We lost loved ones and family members. We were locked in. People were unsure about their babies. And now this is our September 12th moment. Mm-hmm. It's time for us to get up. It's time for us to not be defined by COVID. They had their chance. They threw the best at us with all of those little viruses that we couldn't see. They threw the best at us. Now it's just time to show who we are as most importantly, New Yorkers and as Americans. And that's what today was about. Today was saying our children are going to school without masks. And I know we still want to get the less than 5 years old babies. We're getting them. I need people to trust me. We have to be smart enough not to be reckless as we get out of this COVID wood. But at the same time, it's time for us to say we're not going to be defined through COVID.
You know, you're a lifelong New Yorker. You were born in Brooklyn. You were raised in Queens. And, you know, just as you highlighted, 9/11 was obviously a very, very turbulent time here. But you've seen a lot of turbulent times in the city. You know, I grew up in the New York area, and I remember the 1970s, you know, in the city. I came to New York to live here in the early 1980s and you know, remember the city in the 1980s. How would you describe the state of New York City right now when you kind of put it in this broad historical context?
I think that we're in a good place. The cross-pollination of cultures and ideas. When I grew up, if you were African-American, you were only living in African-American place. If you were from the AAPI community, you would just be in that community. If you were Hasidic or Sephardian, you know, Pakistani, you would only live in certain communities. The young people of the day, they have just dismantled all of these rules. They live what they want. They are doing and experience what they want. You can walk into a Chinese restaurant where the Mexican cook and make you a German meal that he learned from his Italian girlfriend. This place is like,
sounds like Goldman Sachs.
And so when you take that, and then you bring the level. We had a 356% startup under my role as borough president in the 10-year period. The new technology, the new ideas, and the social engagement. People no longer want to have just a job. They want to say, if I buy something, I'm going to trace it back and see if the person who picked the crops are socially responsible. Mm-hmm. We are now realizing that we are all in this together, and you're seeing that play out in New York, and it's an exciting time to be a part of it.
Yeah. I think a lot about being a CEO and what I've got to accomplish. You know, you are the CEO of the largest city in the country, and, you know, you've said publicly, and you just touched on COVID, but you said you're fighting a three-headed crisis: COVID, crime, and economic devastation.
Yes.
What's your number one priority now when it comes to kind of getting New York to regain its financial footing?
It's all together. Mm-hmm. Public safety and justice, they are the prerequisite to prosperity. We have to be safe. If we're not safe, it doesn't matter how much we make. If you are afraid to allow your children to go to school, if you're afraid to have your parents walk the streets, or I saw people who have ridden the train for years, and they say, Eric, this is the first time I am afraid. And safety is actual and it's perceived. Because I could throw all the numbers at you that you want, but if you don't feel safe, then it's a failure.
Yeah.
And so we must zero in on safety, but we cannot be attracted to the heavy-handed policing that we witnessed in the past. That's the danger. Because we're so frustrated by what we are seeing and the erosion of our safety that many people want to say, well, let's just go out and just do whatever that's possible. And I'm not going to do that. We're going to have a safe city, but we're going to make sure that we do it in a manner where we're not going to lose our dignity and dignity of others. I say to my police officers all the time, I'm going to have your backs. I'm not going to send you mixed messages where I'm telling you to enforce a crime, and then when you do so, I'm going to blame you for it. But there's a covenant. You can't be abusive in your actions, and that's very important. But if we're safe, tourism comes back. Mm-hmm. People are willing to come on the trains. You're willing to visit restaurants and walk the streets again. You're willing to spend money in our city, but it starts with a safe foundation. Mm-hmm. That's very important. You
know, people have to feel safe. It's one of the things I hear from our families that live here. It's just the most important thing.
Number one thing.
They feel safe and the children are safe here in the city.
And those are the people who have fled.
Absolutely.
You know, we went to Florida and told them, listen, you know, you got to get your butts back to New York, man. Listen, this is your city. You know, there's only so much sun and beach you can do.
What keeps you up at night?
Our tolerance of each other and are willing to celebrate our diversity. Something happened, I don't want to politicize this, but something happened under the Trump's administration. And I said, his second year, I said, I'm not worried about Trump. We're going to elect him out. I'm not worried about who we're becoming. We couldn't even go to family meals anymore. Everyone went to this space of, I must prove you wrong that I'm right. No one wanted to say, I want to seek to understand so I could be understood. And we're so divided. I mean, we like all went into our own corners and the bell rings and we come out and just fight each other. The increase in hate crime, what's happening to transgenders throughout this entire country, all these things that people are not realizing that there's just a level of just pain that we are experiencing. And I am really concerned about that. And we must find creative ways to do something revolutionary, talking to each other. I had a program called Breaking Bread, Building Bonds, 10 dinners across this, 100 dinners across the city, 10 people at each dinner, and all of them had to come from a different ethnic, religious, or cultural background. And they had to talk to each other using food. I love the lubricating value of a meal. And it's just encouraging people. How do I learn about you? Why do you wear a hijab? Why do you go to a sukkah? What is the African diaspora? And it just was amazing experiences. COVID disrupted that.
Yes.
But we want to go back to that.
We need to go back to that. And civility, you know, there's something that's eroded the civility in society.
Yes.
And,
yes.
And civility is a hugely important foundation to society. And anything we can do to strive to bring that back has got
so
to be
important.
A good thing. I noticed you rang the opening bell of the New York Stock Exchange the other day.
Yes.
And, you know, as I highlighted, you've spoken a lot about building bridges with the business world. And I must say, I'm impressed by your actions and I'm impressed by your words, you know, both publicly and also privately. We had a phone call when you were first elected where you said to me, you know, I'm really glad to talk with you. As goes Goldman Sachs, so goes New York.
Definitely.
And, you know, I really appreciate that. But as you've been meeting with CEOs in New York, what are you saying to business leaders? What can the business community do for you? And what kind of feedback have you been getting from business leaders? Because I know you've made a lot of rounds with business leaders in the community.
You know, I think it's important to understand how much the business community plays a role in the stability of our city. You know, Sheena used to be the head of one of the nonprofits in this city, United Way, and saw how much the business community contributed to so many programs and entities. We have about 35,000 nonprofits, about a little over, I think, $3 billion in payrolls come from that, those nonprofits. What do people believe that money's coming from? It's coming from my corporate leaders. They're putting into the Ford Foundation, to Robin Hood, to some of the smaller entities. And there was a disconnect. And so what I'm saying to my business leaders, number one, we are going to become the most business-friendly city on the globe. We have to stop being anti-business. And number two, I'm asking them for a covenant. I need their help to bridge the gap. There are far too many young people in this city that they know nothing about this. They're born in one square mile. They go to school in one square mile. Their entire existence is in that one square mile. So we need our business community to help us with paid internship programs to expose young people so they can meet other talented young people. We need summer youth employment, a massive one, but it's not just a summer youth employment where you're sitting in a park somewhere. No, we want to teach financial literacy, communication, working in groups, How do you use technology? How do you dress for success? How do you shake a hand? How do you look someone in the eye? Many of these children don't have that. And then corporate responsibilities. Mm-hmm. We need the talent to come into city government and figure out how do we write the curriculum for our schools? Because we talk about our children not being exposed. Our teachers are not being exposed, as Chancellor Banks talks about all the time.
If you look at New York City, the rate of employees returning to the office actually lags behind the rest of the country. It's at about 30% right now, where workers in the metropolitan New York area are swiping into their offices. And you've said very clearly, and I quote you here, the city can't run from home. You've been urging everyone to get employees back to work. You've talked a lot about the economic implications of all this. Explain for everybody here kind of your views of the repercussions to the city's kind of financial ecosystem if we don't get people in Midtown and downtown back into
offices. So true, and I don't want to be a hypocrite because I'm socially awkward. I'm an introvert, you know. My favorite day.
I noticed that about you.
My favorite day is keeping on my pajamas, right, watching Twilight Zone remakes.
I mean, that might be your favorite day. You are not an introvert.
I
mean,
trust that would trust me. And the, but when you start to do an analysis, think about your product, the financial industries, and you go after, let's say, a chain of new businesses opening. So if the accountant is in the corner office, or the financier is in the corner, or is not in the corner office, he's home.
Yeah.
That chain of stores is not having people come inside. No one is going to the cleaners for their suits. No one is stopping in a restaurant for that dishwasher or that cook or that low-wage employee. Business travelers are not coming. 70%, over 70% of our hotel occupancy is tied to business travel.
Business travel, and that's right. Way, way down.
They're not bringing their families to go to the theater, which is a major economic draw for us. There's a financial ecosystem, and no one understands that better than entities like yours. So if you are removed from office, you're not stopping to get that coffee at Starbucks. You're not stopping in the local bodegas. You're not going to the cleaners. It's a collapse of our ecosystem. So there's, you can't say, well, I'm going to stay home, and it's not going to eventually impact you. It's time to come back.
It is time to come back.
And put your toe in the water.
Yeah.
Let's do it for 2-3 days, get used to it again. All of a sudden, going out with your friends, you realize that, wow, I do like doing this again.
Well, that's one of the things we're finding is people come to the office, they're actually enjoying themselves.
Yes.
And they actually remember some of the reasons why, you know, we come together. Although, you know, you highlighted before, one of the issues for people who live and work in the city is public safety, you know, as you had highlighted. And you acknowledged how important the efforts are on this crime front. It's certainly a challenge. Beyond the additional police and mental health workers you've deployed on the streets and in the subways, what other investments, specific investments, do you think are needed to really continue to improve this public safety journey?
That's a great question, because Archbishop Desmond Tutu, one of my mentors who transitioned a few months ago, he stated, we spend a lifetime pulling people out of the river. Mm-hmm. No one goes upstream and prevent them from falling in the first place. Not only do we allow people to fall in the river here in New York, we push them in the river. We have to take our government upstream. Because if we don't have a duality to our approach, we need intervention and prevention. I have to do intervention right now. I have guns on my street right now. I have a homeless crisis right now. I have people walking in stores right now, stealing items with a total disregard. And so I must do some things right now. But then what about the feeders? I must stop the failure of doing dyslexia screening. 30% of our inmates in the country are dyslexic. 55% have learning disabilities. 48% have mental health issues. You'll never stop this flow if you just hang out downstream and pulling people out of the river. So I must do dyslexia screening. I must do wraparound service for people with mental health issues and identify learning disabilities earlier. And that's why I have an amazing team that we put together to look at how do we prevent some of those crises while we are putting in place some real interventions right now. I have to set the right tone. When I saw a individual pour water over the head of a police officer while he was walking away, I said to myself, we lost the city. Mm-hmm. It's not who's wearing that uniform. It's the symbol of stability. When people can walk into a Duane Reade that has low wage employees that need the job and take whatever they want off the shelves and walk out so that Duane Reade is now going to close down and fire those low wage workers, that's unacceptable. When you inject yourself with heroin in front of my child while I'm walking through the park and no one seems to care, when you rubbed human waste in the face of a New Yorker while they're taking the train, we have eroded the expectation of how do we treat each other in a dignified way. And we got to turn that around. That's more than just guns on our streets. That's an erosion of who we are as a city.
So as a police captain of the police force, and as a police officer for 22 years, how is it shaping, you know, your view on, how did that experience shape your view on how to tackle all this, and how challenging has it been to try to make the city safer while also doing some work to reform the police force? So tie that all together.
Great question. Well, number one, you know, there's a saying in the Bible, Esther 4 and 14, God made me for such a time like this. And that's how I feel. I feel that God made me for this moment, being arrested at 15, beat by police officers. Civil rights activists told me to go into the police department. I decided to do so and started an organization that fought for police reform and justice. Being faced with healthcare issues, losing my sight. The doctor told me I was going to be blind in a year, permanent nerve damage in my hands. He said I was going to lose some fingers and toes. Finding a whole food plant-based diet to reverse my diabetes, my vision loss, my nerve damage. So all of these journeys. Went back to sitting inside the kitchen in 1975 when I was arrested, and mommy sent me there and says, baby, you're going to find yourself in dark places. You decide if those dark places is a burial or a planting. Mm-hmm. Turn pain into purpose, son. Mm-hmm. And I hear that all the time. We're at that moment right now. We appear to be in dark places, but we're going to turn this into not a burial, but a planting. And that is how I instruct my police officers, that we could have that combination. People are hurting from the historical interactions between mm-hmm. police and communities. And we have police our cities differently based on neighborhoods and zip codes. We're not going to do that anymore. And because I was there, I know what to do now that I am here.
Let's talk about job creation. Unemployment rate in New York is kind of double the national rate at the moment. It's about 9%. Only 55% of the 1 million jobs that were lost during COVID have been recovered here in the city. So talk a little bit, and I know you've been thinking about this, how do you plan to create more jobs in the city, and where would you like the unemployment rate to realistically be in the city a year from now?
Well, first, we have an amazing deputy mayor, Maria Torres Springer. We're going to roll out a massive job plans, looking at small businesses as well as our large corporations. One, I'm going to do a major tour throughout the entire country, and I'm going to do to other states what they have been doing to us. I'm going to tell all of their businesses, leave them, come to New York. This is the place you want to be. I'm going to show all the benefits of being here. No one has it the way we do, and our most potent weapon, I believe, is located in the young, creative people we have in this city, and we're going to attract them back here. Number two, we have to stop being anti-business. How do you build a hotel ready to hire people, put people inside, but you have to wait 3 years to get a sprinkler inspection? Imagine saving all your money as a dishwasher and opening a restaurant, paying $35,000 a month rent, and you have to wait 2 years for the Department of Buildings to give you a CFO. Or Con Edison to turn on your electricity, or National Grid to turn on your gas. Or God forbid, you about to build affordable housing and you have a tree out front. It's gonna take 3 years for the Department of Parks to move the tree and plant it somewhere else. We have not incentivized a business-friendly environment. So I'm saying to FDNY, I'm not only judging you on how many fires you put out, tell me how many sprinkler inspections you have done, and we're going to do it in real time. Mm-hmm. I'm not judging the Department of Buildings on how many times you gave someone a violation. Tell me how many times you partnered with small business services to get a restaurant open within a predetermined period of time. We are re-examining fines. We are looking at how we should stop, you know, using citations as another form of taxation. And then we're going to encourage businesses to come to the city.
You know, I know you want to attract businesses here. You've talked a lot about tech and a tech hub. You have talked about cybersecurity. You've talked about cryptocurrency. You want to boost life, science, and green jobs. There are a bunch of companies there. You know, you're talking about how do you attract, what is it going to take to get people here? And what are you hearing when you talk to business people and you talk to entrepreneurs? What are they telling you are the impediments to get more people to locate more jobs and more activity here?
Yeah, of course, as we indicated, safety.
Yeah.
You know, people don't
Safety's
feel,
one. Yeah.
Yes, people don't feel safe.
How about tax?
Tax is a real challenge for us. We're probably number two behind, California and Los Angeles. The state is extremely high in its taxes, and we have to be realistic and honest. Mm-hmm. We've wasted taxpayers' dollars. It is imperative that we use taxpayers' dollars better than what we're doing, and that's my goal, mm-hmm. to create a more efficient company. As you indicated, you know, Eric, you're CEO of NYC and company. And if we were one of the Fortune 500 companies, we'd be out of business because of how dysfunctional we are and how we waste taxpayers' dollars. We are not going to be able to decrease taxes anytime soon. Mm-hmm. But what we can do is better use taxpayers' dollars, mm-hmm. to make sure you're getting the product that you deserve. Mm-hmm. Then we must be we're too bureaucratic. No one wants to do business in New York. This is the Empire State. Mm-hmm. We built empires and we moved away from that. And by becoming a more business-friendly environment to find out how do we become the center of biotech. We had a meeting with Pfizer heads to talk about building out the biotech centers, self-driving cars, using drones to inspect buildings, cybersecurity, cannabis growth here, Bitcoin, blockchain. We need to be unafraid of whatever industry. We're going to open in the office an innovation and emerging market unit that's going to just focus on what is out there globally to see how that we run our city better, but become a business. When I sit down with my biotechs, I shouldn't dictate to them. I should ask them, how do I become attractive enough to want you to be here? Yeah. What must I do to make that happen? And that is what we're doing now.
You know, shifting gears a little, the death and destruction caused by Hurricane Ida touched off a great debate about the city's preparedness for climate change. What's the best course of action to build resilience in the city and protect the city from rising sea levels, flooding?
Well, certainly, we're going to see again. Yeah. Well said. But, you know, Ida did something else. Mm-hmm. See, you know, Mother Nature is something. We thought we were slick. Oh, we're going to build up walls and everything is going to be fine. Yeah, Mother Nature said, yeah, we have something for you. You know, it wasn't the sea that was rising. It was the rain. Yeah. When I was out there, I saw the Brooklyn Bridge flood, mm-hmm. the entry ramp.
Yeah.
I never saw that before.
Yeah.
So Mother Nature is telling us there's no Band-Aids on this. You have to change your way of life. And it's going to come with a host of things. Number one, as we announced a few days ago, we're going to be building the largest wind port and wind farm by building the actual wind turbines here in Sunset Park. It's a major investment. But we also announced a pipeline for employment. Far too many young people are watching these new industries and they don't see the employment that comes with it.
Yeah.
But number two, we have to do the things that we can. That's within our power. We must become carbon neutral. Yep. We have to hit the goals that we put in place. Everything from recycling, not symbolically, but in a real way, teaching these jobs in our schools, doing everything from solar paneling to making sure that our city agencies participate in the recovery effort. We put a great environmental team together that's going to zero in on how do we use electronic vehicles? How do we attract them here? Charging stations, incentivizing. There's some great products in Israel that they're doing around, you don't need standard charging stations, that you could just charge vehicles as they're driving throughout streets. So we are really moving beyond the safety of our shores to find real ways of becoming carbon neutral, and we are on course to do so.
That's really great. You know, New York City is home to the largest Ukrainian community in this country. Governor Hochul said that New York would welcome refugees. I know you met with some members of the Ukrainian community in Brooklyn over the weekend. Talk about preparation the city's making to support Ukrainian refugees.
That war is a stain on humanity, and it shows the aggression. And I don't think we should take it lightly. Anyone that's a basic study of history realize that global conflicts happen out of small engagements like what we're witnessing right now. Number one, what happens on the global stage plays out on our streets. Yes, we have one of the largest, if not the largest, Ukrainian population in America. We also have one of the largest Russian-speaking populations.
Absolutely, yeah.
And so we have to get on the ground. That's why I went to Brighton Beach over the weekend and walked the streets and visited Coney Island Hospital, where 25% of their workforce is Russian-speaking and a large Ukrainian population. We must get on the ground and make sure we don't create a conflict between the communities and have others start attacking these communities. But in addition to that, we have to ask them. I met with the Council General today. We had lunch this afternoon at a Ukrainian restaurant and asked, how do we help? What are some of the items they need, such as basic supplies? We've displaced, millions of people are going to be displaced. Mm-hmm. And it's imperative for New York and America to have their traditional role of allowing people who are fleeing terror or tyranny to be able to come to this country and give them the assistance that they need. We've done it before. We know how to do this.
Yep.
And we need to do it again.
That's really well said. You know, this conflict heightens focus on cybersecurity. You know, you had rolled out New York's statewide cyber command center in Brooklyn just ahead of this invasion in the Ukraine. In light of all the geopolitical uncertainty, on a scale of 1 to 10, how concerned are you about cyber risk and kind of the risk to the city's critical infrastructure?
12.
12, okay. I thought you were gonna say 10, but I didn't realize 12 was an option, but you mirror my concern.
Yeah, one thing the former mayor said to me as we were transitioning and I was at Gracie Mansion, he was a little late coming in, and I remember like it was yesterday, he walked inside the room and he says, Eric, COVID is not our crisis. He says, Eric, cybersecurity is our crisis. Because we have built our lives on a foundation of technology, everything from our phones to how we communicate, how we do business, and our basic infrastructure from the water supplies to our how do we commute, is all connected. And people are attempting to attack every day, hundreds of thousands of times a day. And we need to be really conscious of that. And so what we're doing, we brought on board an amazing chief technology officer, Matt Frazier. And what Matt is doing is one, we partner with the state, so we're all saying the same things and coordinate together at our cyber command center, 11 Metro Tech. But second, we're going out to our business community and say, we are all Team New York. What are you guys doing? How do we learn from you? And if we see a threat coming in, how do we let you know and vice versa? Because we have already witnessed cities and states that have been held hostage. You know, Atlanta went under attack. We had an attack here with our law department, some cities in New Jersey. And so this is a real threat that can actually cripple our infrastructure here. And so we are keenly aware of it. It's not a sexy agenda. No one's going to be judged, but it has to be done.
No, it has to be done. It's not an easy fix.
Right.
There are going to be bumps, but it's great that there's so much focus. You know, anytime you enter a new job, there's unexpected. what's been surprising? What's been unexpected in these early days?
That's a great question. You know, when you are a police officer, you know, your days are so varied. You could wake up in the day and respond to a shooting. Then you could go help someone find a lost child. You can go to a heart attack victim, a fire, plane landing on the Hudson River. It is so varied that, you know, really the term surprise just doesn't leverage. When I wake up every day, I say to myself, this is New York. Anything could happen.
Anything could happen.
You might as well get used to it. No use whining. You know, my mother used to say, boy, that's the job you ask for, so shut up. And so I have not been really surprised. We have 8.8 million New Yorkers and 20 million opinions. Mm-hmm. When I walk out and I see people standing in front of City Hall protesting me or yelling at me, when I say, yes, this is New York, man.
I had heard that you sought Mike Bloomberg's advice, you know, as you were, you know, sometime, I guess, you know, over the course of the last months. What did he tell you?
Just a host of things. First of all, you know, everyone ran around with that commercial about Jordan, but I like to be like Mike. I like Mike. You know that. This personality, we speak just about every Wednesday, and Mike will have you rolling on the floor laughing. This guy is so funny.
Can be. Yeah, he can be.
But he, you know, when you think about this, he could go anywhere he wants. Mm-hmm. And we had this brilliant man on the sideline for 8 years. I mean, he was saying, Coach, put me in the game.
Yeah.
What he's doing nationally, mm-hmm. internationally, mm-hmm. And he brought us a group, he brings a group of mayors together and talk about how do we coalesce together. What he's doing around gun, our town, how he's, the benevolence of what he's doing. And so when we sit down and talk, he just gives me simple advice on just everyday things. I'm able to reach out to him and, you know, he's a great mentor. He has been amazing with our team. Mm-hmm. And he's just basically, you know, make a decision.
Yeah.
Give clarity and make a decision. That's why we handled the school openings the way we did. Mm-hmm. Clarity is the key from New Yorkers. And yeah. Mike has taught me that during our conversations and about the importance of really engaging our business community and supporting the right way our police officers so they can do their job.
Politicians always get evaluated on their first 100 days. You're, you know, somewhere around day 65, I think, or something like that, somewhere between 65 and 70. On April 10th, what will you have achieved for New York?
Well, first, being mayor is like, every day is like dog years.
You know? That's true.
Because you know, so much happens in one day. But I think our real strength, we're going to have some successes. Mm-hmm. We're going to create a more business-friendly environment. We're going to do some great things around the foundation of education. We need mayoral accountability. We're going to zero in on crime. You're going to see a visual change in the unsafety feeling you're seeing in our subway system by removing the encampments that you're witnessing now. So there's going to be some W's for us. But the real goal of my administration, people always ask, just give me the two things that you want to do. That's not where I'm going. I must change the foundation of a dysfunctional city that creates its crises. And that's not always attractive because people can't wrap their hands around it and say, point to pre-K or point to this. No, I'm going to look at how this covenant between government and citizens have been destroyed. Cities are made up of agencies. If the agencies are not doing their primary responsibilities, it doesn't matter how much taxes you pay. Mm-hmm. Our agencies are failing the city. Good people in them, but we have the wrong leadership in too many agencies. I must get my agencies functioning, and that is not the most attractive thing to do, but you're going to see in the first 100 days the starting process of an entity and an administration that we're just going to get stuff done. For New Yorkers,
when do you think about a legacy when you're done? Do you think about what you'd like your legacy to be?
That we turned a city that created crises into a city that prevented and created opportunities that would finally end the inequalities, the historical inequalities in our city. A safe, clean city where we can raise healthy children and families. That is the legacy that I want. I want people to. My legacy is going to be a retrospective appreciation that this was the mayor that put us on the right course.
Mayor Adams, so nice of you to come. You've got a lot going on. So nice of you to come. Be with us. Be here in the office. Be present. Show up. Spend time with our people. We really appreciate it. Goldman Sachs is ready to partner with you to continue to strengthen this great city.
Thank you
so much. Appreciate it.